Well, hello, you malty. Mechanical toys. Yes. I don't think you're a mechanical toy. However, David has suggested that as a malt mention, so that will do for me. Welcome to Whisky Review 425. Now, not quite a regular whisky review this, because for the simple reason that occasionally when I'm thinking my deep malty thoughts, picking my nose and scratching my arse, as one does, but never in reverse order, I thought to myself, you know, it's all very well for whisky fans around the world to get opinions on single malts from Scotland, blends from Scotland, bourbons from the USA, whiskies from Japan, rums from the Caribbean, etc. But now and again, it's worth having a vlog that's whisky related, but providing you with extra information, additional information, so that whatever you're drinking, wherever you are, you're just that little bit more informed and that little bit more aware of what you're drinking and why the flavour is the way it is. Now, take any brown spirit. I've got a bottle of whiskey here. This will do fine as an example. A nice natural colour, that. Do you see that colour? That amber colour. It is an indication that this is what is termed in the beverage industry as a brown spirit. Good examples of brown spirits include rum, cognac, bourbon, whisky. There you go. There are others. And the suggestion is that unlike clear spirits like vodka and gin, which are bottled shortly after their distillation, brown spirits are longer in preparation because they are matured after distillation in wooden casks. And the idea is that the brown in brown spirits is the natural extracts which occur from cask maturation. Now, it's not always the case. It's well documented that there is the addition of E150A colourant to single malts, particularly blends. And you know my thoughts on extra colour in single malts. I think they're pretty well documented here at Ralphie.com. But something that you might not know is that there are some brown spirits out there which are not matured in wood at all. They're merely coloured artificially. With maybe a natural colourant that's added, but it's done so cosmetically to give the appearance of maturation. No names at the moment. It's a wee, perhaps a little sleuthing job for you. Can do your Sherlock Holmes and find out which ones they are. Back to Scotch, back to whisky, back to maturation, which is going to start in 1915. 1915, quite a long time ago, about, let me say, yes, 99 years ago, was when the whisky industry got a little bit upset with the Chancellor of the Exchequer in the Parliament in London. His name was Lloyd George, quite a prominent politician in his age, and he wasn't a fan of alcohol. In fact, he sided very much with the prohibitionists for the simple reason that an awful lot of bad drinking was taking place in these days, much as there is now, but that's another story. And so he decided to impose regulation on the whisky industry by passing a law under the Immature Spirits Act of 1915, yeah? And the idea was that it would take longer for the spirits to be ready to go to market, and this would put a little bit of pressure on the Scotch whisky industry, and perhaps people might drink less. It didn't work. In fact, quite by accident and default, not through any systematic planning, whisky suddenly had to be matured in casks for a minimum of 3 years prior to being able to be called whisky, prior to being bottled and prior to being sold. Now, this worked in the whisky industry's favour because it is a fact that over time, if a spirit, a new-made spirit, is put into a cask, rather like this. This is a model cask. Imagine one a bit bigger than this, about this size, this one here. 260, 280 litres. Standard bourbon cask. Well, you put the spirit into the cask and then a maturation takes place. I'm going to discuss this maturation with you. I'm going to explain a little bit more about what it is and how it refines and tones down and builds and improves the flavour of the spirit. Wooden casks, certainly under Scotch whisky regulations, but not whisky regulations in other countries. Take note. Whisky must be matured for a minimum of 3 years in wooden oak casks. Note, oak casks. No other wood can be used for Scotch, only oak. Any kind of oak, by the way, not necessarily American or European oak. The regulations simply state oak. And the vessel that's used for making the cask, the size of the cask, it must not exceed 700 litres capacity. So, here we have a few examples of these casks, and basically I'm going to introduce these casks and explain how they affect the new make spirit. But we've got to go back to 1950. I'm going to start there because Scotland was churning, and I do mean churning out, a lot of bad, poor quality liquor. And the idea was, if it's rough, beef it up with flavours. From malt whisky, peated malt whisky as well, blend them out with the smoother grain and we can pass them off. And very, very little new-made spirit, or usquebae, was in fact matured in casks. The people who were maturing whisky in casks were the professional classes and the aristocracy who would be buying their claret and their brandy and their wine in full-size casks. And what they would do is when they'd finished their wine or their claret or their brandy or their sherry, what they would do is they would keep the empty casks in their wine cellars or in their pantries, and then they'd take their new-made spirit from the stills, pour them into the casks and leave them in the knowledge that over time the quality of the liquor would actually improve, not just in flavour, but in smoothness, complexity, and that the rough notes in the new make spirit, which tend to accompany the use of a traditional pot still, well, they would kind of tone down. And the fact is that it's the first 3 years of maturation which have the biggest influence, in my opinion, in the regulation and conditioning of a new made spirit, particularly if a fresh cask is used. Now, there's mainly two kinds of casks. There are American bourbon casks, which are primarily, not always, made with, and I'll give you the Latin name here, with Quercus alba, which is American oak. These oak trees in America, they grow up to maturity in about 70 to 90 years, depending on their altitude above sea level. And then they are cut down, felled, and allowed to rest. Importantly, the trees are allowed to rest before they are then cut into staves. Here we are. I've got a stave here. I'll show you it. I'll explain more about this shortly. And then traditionally they would be stacked up to air dry so that over a couple of years the moisture inside the wood, the volume of that moisture would reduce from at least 30%, if not more, down to a much more useful 7 to 8, perhaps even up to 12% prior to the cooper's shaping and the wooden staves and constructing oak, fresh oak casks. So the regulations for bourbon in America is that you must, by law, use fresh-made American oak casks, generally American oak. But you can't reuse them and call your spirit bourbon. Oh, not allowed. However, you can reuse your bourbon cask so long as you rename your bourbon as whiskey. There you go. So this is what a cask looks like. I have some working examples here from this little tiny model for a tabletop. It's made primarily, it's a bowed shape. Now the reason for the bowed shape, the curve in the cask, is quite simple. Strength. You have some gimmick in the past where square casks were made because they wouldn't roll about so much, particularly in ships. However, square casks or oval casks are inherently weak and prone to leak, so no good. You're better with nice round casks, like this one here. A cask is made up of wooden staves and barrel ends, which are slotted together and held in place very tightly by steel rims. Now, I have here a stave. This happens to be the stave with the bung hole. The bung itself, which is the wooden piece that goes in to seal the cask shut once you've filled it, isn't actually made of oak. They do use plastic ones in the whisky industry now, but traditionally it was made of poplar, because poplar is a nice springy wood. And it tends to kind of seal off the hole in the stave quite effectively. The problem with poplar is it's actually quite a weak wood as well, and this is not uncommon for distillers, as they're checking through in the warehouses, to break these, and therefore they always have spares to replace them. So there it is, the poplar bung, which fits in to this hole, which is the filling and emptying point of the cask. When you move inside, you will see, now this was a bourbon cask, how black it is. A very simple reason for that. This has been charred, so that when this cask was made, prior to being filled with new made spirit, it was exposed to considerable direct heat. It was fired, and that would create a lot of carbon on the surface of the inside of this the cask. Now that's very useful, because carbon is very good at absorbing impurities, and in doing so smoothing and rounding down the coarser flavors of the whiskey and making it taste more refined. If it's a European oak cask, which are regularly used in the Scotch whisky industry, they tend to be larger casks made from Sicilia, Lamazan or other European oaks. There are 2,000 species of oak in the world. Approximately 30 varieties are used for the construction of casks. Why oak? Because it's just the ideal texture and kind of wood for actually the construction of casks. And it's the cheapest, strongest and cheapest, simple as that. Bear in mind, malt mates, other woods can be used outside of Scotland for maturing spirits. Beer producers also use non-oak casks for maturing and conditioning beer. Popular woods are chestnut and cherry. Back to barrels. In European casks, they're using European oak, which is Quercus robur. Yep. American oaks, Quercus alba. European oaks, Quercus robur. That's the Latin names. And it's a bit more slow-growing European oak. And it also, because a subsequence of being more growing more slowly it, and having a different character to it, it tends to impart more dried fruit perhaps honey notes. Certainly tannins gives more tannin, and it is the custom in European oak casks, whether being used for sherry or wine, that they are not actually charred directly. There may be a very light char put onto European casks, but in fact they are toasted, so it's a lower heat for a longer period of time. And what that does, the lower heat, is it cooks the juices and the flavourings that are natural part of the wood. Who would think there's a lot of flavour to be found in wood? We don't realise it because we don't eat wood. We associate flavours with what we eat and what we can digest. We don't eat wood. It's indigestible. It's made of cellulose. You know what it is? It's a big, brittle sponge. And here, if we look at the end of this stave, you're going to see running up the middle is a little dark line. That is called the tide line. And what happens when you put new-made spirit into an oak cask? Bear in mind, the majority of that spirit, averaging about 65% if it's Scotch new-made spirit, well, it's a solvent. And as a solvent, it gets absorbed into the wood in the casks, because they are a very dense sponge. That's what wood is. Strong, dense sponge. And the spirit will suffuse into the wood, and as it does, the solvents and the alcohol dissolve the flavourings in the wood and extract them out into the contents of the cask, into the maturing spirit. So what you have is a two-way process. The new spirit is leaching and being drawn into the wood of the cask, and at the same time, flavours in the wood are being drawn out into the spirit. And the spirit, ethanol, what we're drinking, it's what the alcohol is, well, its property is that it physically bonds the chemicals which are responsible for smell and flavour. Now, I notice the word physical, that's important. It's a chemical reaction. If you take a piece of paper and you put a match to it and you burn it, it's a chemical reaction because it's irreversible. You cannot unash back to paper. With water being frozen to ice, that is not a chemical reaction. That is a physical reaction. Why? Because it's reversible. As the temperature lowers, the water freezes. As the temperature rises, the water thaws. So what starts as water goes through the reaction and then can be returned back to its original state. And what alcohol does is it bonds and attracts the little molecules of flavour and binds them to itself. And over time in casks, these flavours layer up like sediment in the bottom of a lake. That's what they do. Like the layers inside an onion. And this adds more and more complexity to the flavour, more colour and character and variety to the flavour that's already in the spirit. But it doesn't stop there, you see, because in every cask, when it's filled, there'll be a gap of air. And in the air is oxygen, and oxygen oxidises. What is one of the most recognisable signs or examples of oxidisation? Simple. When iron rusts. Rust is iron oxide. So I think it's iron oxide. I'm not a chemist. Probably got that one wrong. Moving on, show must go on. When iron rusts, it's because of the presence of oxygen breaking down the molecules of iron and creating the rust. When oxygen comes in contact with alcohol, in a different way, the same thing happens. Some of the flavours get broken down, some of the long, complex chains of flavour molecules. Due to oxidisation, they break down and they change. And so what you have is not a superficial two-way process of spirit into cask, flavour from wood into spirit. It's more complex than that, because over time, some flavours are gained, some flavours are lost, some flavours change, some flavours diminish in prominence, and some flavours grow in provenance. And then, on top of all that, you've got the position where the cask is stored. Now, if it's stored in a traditional warehouse, which is slightly damp, that dampness will have its own long-term effect. It can be very slight. It might not be slight. It might be a bit more prominent. It just depends on provenance. But location has a lot to do with the type of maturation that takes place and the extent of maturation that takes place. So if you have a damp environment, slightly damp, with an even temperature, you may find, like Highland Park Distillery, you don't get a lot of losses of spirit, and you tend to get quite a sustained and even-natured maturation. Whereas if your cask is lying in the top deck of a warehouse in a hot climate on sustained sunny days where the temperature's fluctuating a lot, you may find that your spirit is not so settled. There's much more inhibition of caliber of maturation due to the temperatures unsettling things. That's the great thing about these old dunnage warehouses. They promote even temperatures in a better way than modern prefabricated warehouses. There we go. Is there more? You bet there is. Cask size. Right. Now we've got little cask, medium cask, great big cask. So let's pretend this is a sherry butt of about 650 litres capacity. And this is a bourbon cask of about 280 litres capacity. And let's pretend that this is a little blood cask of no more than 60 litres capacity. If I was to fill all three of these casks with exactly the same spirit, after 10 years, I'd get three very, very different tasting whiskies. Why? Because the smaller the cask, the greater the ratio of surface contact between spirit and wood. And that means maturation happens faster. Not just the exchange of flavours from cask into spirit, but the actual process, the breathing of the cask. That wood is porous. And what happens is that with the change in atmospheric pressure, you have this very slow breathing of the wood, which can enhance or diminish oxidization of the spirit. It can have a big effect if there's a big change in atmospheric pressure, or a small change if there's not a lot of change in atmospheric pressure. And on top of that, finally, you have provenance. What is provenance? It's the thing that the whisky industry chemists find hardest to pin down. You know, they've come a long way in terms of research and understanding just how the maturation of whisky really, really works. But how come you could take two identical casks, put them side by side in the same warehouse for 10 years with the same spirit in them from the same still run? How come you get two different tasting whiskies? That's part of the magic of matured spirits, of brown spirits. It's part of the allure of them, the fascination of them, is that even now there's a great deal of understanding how it works and how it happens, but there's not a complete 100% understanding. And do you know what? I think that's a good thing. I think I'll call it a day now. I think that's quite enough for one vlog. I hope you found this interesting. I'm not even going to touch inner staves. I'm not even going to go about stave runnelling, about ultrasound and casks. I'm not even going to go about sealing with beeswax, about rotation of casks. At some point, I'll cover the difference between traditional and palletage on casks. Bourbon casks tend to be pallet matured in America. Scotch whisky casks tend, traditionally, if done the traditional way, tend to be matured on their sides rather than their ends, and that can have an influence on the results, a big influence. But I'm not even going to go there now. I'm just going to conclude this video by saying, if you come back again shortly for Whisky Review 426, I will be reviewing this very interesting 17-year-old independent bottling, Bowmore. Now, as you know, I'm not a fan of Bowmore, but there are some good ones out there, and I've found one, and I'm going to share my experiences and personal opinion with you in Whisky Review 426. Thank you for watching. I hope you find this interesting. I know I'm throwing an awful lot of information at you, which isn't a whisky review as such, but I hope that in having awareness of this, you will basically get more out of the whisky, rum, bourbon, or whatever it is you're drinking. Ciao.